Hello, B here, and welcome back to Integrated Physics and Chemistry. For our lesson today, we're going to start with a quick trip back to the year 1628. In the heart of 17th century Sweden, the mighty warship Vasa had just been completed and was a marvel of naval engineering. It was intended to be the crown jewel of the Swedish fleet, but some had doubts about its design. Sure enough, only minutes into its maiden voyage, a gentle gust of wind caught the sails and caused the ship to tilt dangerously. Before any intervention was possible, water began to rush in through the open gun ports. The great Vasa, with all its grandeur, sank right in the harbor in front of hundreds of onlookers who had gathered to see it off. In the 1900s, it was recovered from the bottom of the harbor and now is a well-known tourist attraction at a museum in Stockholm. But why did it sink in the first place? Why do any objects sink or float? That's what we'll find out today. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to predict whether an object will sink or float based on density, and explain how Archimedes' principle relates to buoyancy. In our previous lesson, we reviewed the concept of density, which tells us how much mass per unit volume an object has. One easy way to predict whether an object will sink or float is to consider its density. Let's try some examples. We know that ice floats in water and other beverages. This is because ice is less dense than the liquid it is placed in. What about this piece of cork and a small iron weight? Do you think they will sink or float in the glass of water? Let's consider the density of each before we make a prediction. The cork has a lower density than water, while the iron weight has a higher density than water. Use this information to make a prediction in your notes. The cork floats while the iron sinks. Remember that when we first learned about density, we said that objects will always float if their density is less than that of the fluid they are placed in. But did you know that it's not just the density of the object that matters? The density of the fluid matters too. Look at this example. Why does the egg float in one fluid but not the other? Both eggs have the same density, but the beaker on the left is filled with salt water, while the beaker on the right is filled with fresh water. Which type of water must be more dense based on the results you see here? Salt water has a slightly higher density, which means that the egg is less dense than salt water, but more dense than fresh water. If you've ever gone swimming in the ocean, you may have noticed that it's easier to float in ocean water than in pool water for this same reason. So, a simple way to answer the question, why did the Vasa sink, is to say that the ship must have become more dense than the seawater it was floating in. In order to float, ships depend on having a large amount of empty space inside them, only filled with air, which is far less dense than water. If these spaces become filled with water instead, the density of the ship increases, and this can cause it to sink. In the case of the Vasa, the water rushed in when the ship tipped on its side, allowing water into the open gun ports. Considering density gives us a quick way to determine whether an object will sink or float. But why? We know that all changes in motion, including sinking, are caused by the combination of forces on an object. So, which forces determine whether an object sinks or floats? In our previous lesson, we said that fluid pressure causes a force to be put on an object from every direction while it is submerged in a fluid. Consider this metal screw that has just been dropped into a beaker of water. We know that the water puts a force on the screw from all directions due to fluid pressure. The force from the left and right simply cancel out because they are the same magnitude but push in opposite directions on the same object. What about the up and down forces? Are they equal as well? Not quite. Remember what we said in our previous lesson about the density and pressure that exists within a column of a fluid. Where is the water pressure higher? Above the screw or below it? Below, because the density of water is greater here, so there is more force pushing up from the water than down. This difference in fluid pressure below and above the object is known as buoyancy, and we call these forces from the fluid buoyant forces. Anytime the upward force is greater than the downward force, the object will float. But we just said that the upward buoyant force will always be greater than the downward buoyant force due to the difference in pressure. So how can anything ever sink? Well, there's another force at work here that we haven't considered yet. What is it? The downward force of gravity always adds to the downward buoyant force. So the sum of these two forces must still be less than the upward buoyant force in order for the object to float. In the case of our metal screw, you can probably guess that the force from gravity will tip the scale in favor of the downward forces, and it will sink. So, the magnitude of the buoyant force determines whether an object sinks or floats. But how can we find the magnitude of that force? This mystery was actually solved over 2,000 years ago in ancient Greece by the scientist Archimedes. Even in ancient times, it was no secret that when an object is placed in water, it takes up space that the water previously filled. Archimedes' principle explains how this displaced water relates to buoyancy. Let's look at an example. Consider this 7-kilogram block that is about to be placed in a beaker of water. What will happen to the water in the beaker once it is submerged? A volume of water equal to the volume of the block will be displaced. In this case, we catch that displaced water and weigh it. Archimedes discovered that the upward buoyant force on the object will always be equal to the weight of the water that it displaces. Our 7-kilogram block displaced 2 kilograms of water, so that's the upward force. Will it sink or float? The metal block has a larger mass than the water it displaced, so it sinks. In the case of a ship, the part of the hull that is underwater must displace enough water such that the mass of the ship is less than the mass of the displaced water. This is what went wrong with the Vasa. Once a large part of the hull filled with water, the mass of the ship increased, and the buoyant force from the displaced water was no longer enough to keep it afloat. As we went through the lesson today, we saw how both density and buoyant forces can be used to explain the process of sinking or floating. Using density, we know that if the density of the fluid is greater than the density of a submerged object, the object will float. If we consider buoyant forces, an object will float if the upward buoyant force is greater than the downward force due to gravity. The upward buoyant force can be determined using Archimedes' principle, which says that the upward force is equal to the weight of the fluid displaced by the object. Next time, we'll take a look at the contributions of another scientist, Daniel Bernoulli, and see how his discovery relates to the accomplishment of human flight. Until then, remember, the universe is vast and full of surprises, so never stop exploring! I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.